thank you for your patience. I know we were running late, so thank you for your patience. So we talked about randomized control trials, which was an experimental method. Now we're going to talk about in the cases when you cannot do randomized control trials because they're unethical, they're infeasible, or they're costly. There could be many reasons why you cannot implement an RCT. So how do we evaluate if we cannot use an RCT, which is the situation of most of us, where we cannot use RCTs. So what would we do in that case? We would follow a quasi-experimental method, right? These are more doable for us in situations where RCTs are not possible. And so they allow for second best impact evaluation when RCT is not possible. Like I mentioned, identical twins would be the ideal state, but there aren't that many identical twins in the world, and so we can't assign them to every possible situation to figure out the effect of a program or a policy. So the next best is RCT, and then when you cannot do an RCT, we have quasi-experimental designs, right? So there's a whole bunch of these. Sorry. So there's difference in difference, propensity score matching, regression discontinuity design, and natural experiments. There's a whole bunch of these. And you can also use, you can use each of these individually, but you can also use them in a combination as well, right? So these are the methods, broad methods that are available to us to be able to evaluate. As I mentioned, and I'll remind you again, I'm only going to introduce these today because if we went into details, we'd need at least 2-3 days more to talk about each of these in detail. So this is just to give you an introduction to some of these methods. So we'll talk about difference in difference first. So what difference in difference does is it compares changes in outcomes, in desired outcomes, for participants and non-participants. So it compares changes. So you remember the Rushev graph I had showed you, the first initial graph, where we had two regions, and for both those regions, on the day that the program was implemented, right after that, we saw a decline, right? Just the very first Russian graph I showed you. So what was the difference between that? We all agreed, I think, that that was a bad idea, that wasn't a good way to do an evaluation. But here am I telling you that there's this method called difference in difference. So what do you think might be the difference between the bad Russia example and me telling you about this method? So there also you were looking at two different points of time, before the project started and after, or the day the project started and after, right? So it was a change over time. What is the difference between DID or difference in difference? Any guesses? Yeah, good. Even if it's a guess, that's fine. You're really lucky you're not the experts. So you can say whatever it is you want.
That is for the people who participated, and this is actually for the people who not participated.
Good job. Yes. So one difference is that showed two regions which participated in the pilot. There was no non... In subsequent graphs, I showed you other regions. But in that very first graph, there were only two lines which showed you the two regions that participated in the pilot. So there was no comparison group, right? So that's one difference, or that is probably the most significant difference between this method and the other method. So in the Russian example, you saw only the participants over a period of time. You saw them at the beginning of the project and you saw them at the end of the project, right? Difference in difference looks at the same thing, but also includes a control group or a comparison group. So it allows you to measure two groups rather than just looking at the same group at two different points in time, right? So it builds, here I said the Russian case study measured before and after, but it didn't have a control group, so DID improves on that model of just looking at pre and post, right? So there is a key identification. So there, all of these methods come with some amount of assumptions when you use them. And what is the assumption in this case? The assumption is you're looking at two different points of time. You're looking at before and after. Let's just take the treatment group for now. You're looking at them in 1992, and you're looking at them in 1997, right? What could have changed during this period? It's clearly not only the number of abortions that are changing, the whole country is changing over a period of 5 years or 10 years. There may be economic progress, maybe women are better able to access medical services, but maybe they're also better educated, and so that will affect your abortion rates, right? So parallel trends, what it's saying is for both, and then the same also applies to the control group. So the treatment group is experiencing some changes in the 10 years that the project was run, or the 5 years, or the 2 years, but you have a control group which is also experiencing those same changes because that control group lives in the same region or in the same country or whatever. And that is known as the parallel trend in the absence of the program. So the assumption you're making is that in order to make DID a valid method, we have to assume that whatever the economic growth was, or if there was a famine, or whatever the other external influences influenced or affected both the treatment group and the control group in exactly the same way, right? When you learn to do this method statistically in a software, they teach you how to control for certain variables. And so we would control for any external influences which could have affected both the treatment group and the control group. But the reason this beats the Russian graph that I showed you is because it has a control group, and then we can, if there was a famine, for instance, in those regions, or if there was an earthquake in those regions, you know that both the treatment group and the control group were affected by that. And so we make an assumption when we use this method that both, if there were any external influences, they affected both the treatment group and the control group in the same way. And then there are statistical ways to make sure that was true. So you can look at income levels before and after an earthquake in the treatment group and the control group, and see whether average income levels are the same before and after the earthquake, etc. So there are statistical ways to test for this, but this is one of the assumptions that is made. Limitations of this particular method. So you have pre-programmed data and you have post-programmed data that is required for both participants and non-participants. So it's not enough to, usually there's no problem coming up with data for participants, because here's this group we are spending money on. We obviously know what's their name, where they live, and all those kind of details are available for that group. The difficulty comes in people who are not participating. Why should they give us their data? That's a question to ask. But there are sometimes, depending on what your research question is, sometimes there are existing data sets that already have that information available. So in the US, for instance, social security numbers is a way that, like we have our PAN card numbers, for instance. The Indian government doesn't share that, but say I wanted to know income level in a particular household, that would be one way to collect data on those particular households who are not participating in treatment. So before you use this method, the warning is that you have to be aware, or you have to make sure that either you do a survey to collect that data from those households, or you make sure there's an existing data set that already has it. So maybe if you're working with schools, and only half the schools are being assigned to treatment, you know, schools already have records of children who are not participating, who are your control group. They already know what's the name of the child, what's the age of the child, where they live, all those kind of things. So then before you decide to use this method, you would have to talk to the schools and say, we need information on these particular households, right? So this is one of the things to be aware of. So here's an example. I'll give the example and then I'll stop and ask if there are questions, because I think it would make it easier. So you know, across the world, there is this global debate on minimum wages. What happens when you increase minimum wages? People have different opinions. And this graph just shows that this research study asked a bunch of people that would raising, this study was done in the US, would raising the minimum wage to X amount per hour, would it make it harder for low-skilled people to find employment? So this was a study that asked this question. And as you can see, people had a number of opinions. Some strongly agreed, some strongly disagreed. They asked average people on this graph, and then the other side of the graph is they asked experts on, do you think an increase in minimum wage would mean that because the wages go up, employers will stop hiring people or will cut down the number of people that they hire, right? And you see the expert responses. But as part of that study, they found an interesting experiment site. This wasn't a randomized control trial, but here's what happened. So New Jersey and Pennsylvania are two states that are neighboring states in the US. And in 1 year, in 1992, New Jersey raised its minimum wage by 80 cents. So it went from like $4.25 to about $5.05 or something. So that was the minimum wage. New Jersey decided to increase its wages, but the neighboring state did not. And these states are like literally close to each other, sort of like UP and Delhi, where people freely live in Pennsylvania and go to work in New Jersey or vice versa. It's very easy to go across both states. So these two neighboring states, one state raises the minimum wage level, the other state doesn't. So this is a good opportunity. The researchers saw a good opportunity to check what is the real effect on employment. Does increase of the minimum wage, does it really decrease the chances of low-skilled workers finding employment? They compared this, Carden Kruger are the researchers who did this. They compared 410 fast food restaurants. In the US, fast food restaurants are the ones that are generally the largest employers of low-skilled labor because they pay only minimum wage. They don't give the workers anything like insurance or pension or anything. So typically these low-skilled workers are people with very low levels of education who are very poor, or they are students who are trying to pay their fees and survive, right? So,
can I ask something?
Sure.
See, have you conducted any research on such issue in India, minimum wages, unemployment issues?
I'm not sure about that. I think some of the labor economists, I'm sure, have looked into.
UK is different. US is also different.
Yeah.
When it comes to that payment of minimum wages.
Yeah.
But India is horrible.
Yeah.
It is. I conducted some empirical research on this particular issue.
Okay, that's great.
See, so, notified minimum wages are hardly given to workers. They are not in a position to demand for that.
Yeah, I agree. So in this case, we're just looking at the method, not the findings really. I'm only trying to demonstrate how difference in difference approach worked in this case. So these guys, the researchers, looked at 410 fast food restaurants in both states, right? Now this was not a random assignment because the fast food restaurants in New Jersey had to increase their minimum wage by law. And Pennsylvania did not have to increase, right? The other thing to understand is some restaurants were already paying the higher minimum wage because they wanted to. Other restaurants were paying exactly the minimum wage and would be affected by the new law, right? So some restaurants in New Jersey were already paying either the increased minimum wage just because, you know, they were nicer to their employees, or they were paying even higher. But there were several restaurants that were paying exactly minimum wage, and those were the ones most likely to be affected by the new law, right? So what happened was that in both sets of states, the researchers compared what happened to employment after minimum wage was increased in New Jersey. And the finding here was that relative to Pennsylvania, New Jersey stores actually increased employment by 13%. So employment, you know, the conventional thinking will tell you that when minimum wages go up, employers are now going to say, oh, now I have to pay people more, so I'm going to hire fewer people, and that means a lot more work for the people who are already working there, right? But this study actually found that employment increased. So one caveat to this, and I'll show you the difference in difference on the next slide, but I just want to say one caveat to this is that the authors analyzed this impact 6 to 7 months, so it's a short-term effect of the minimum wage. It doesn't mean this result will necessarily hold if the study was done a year later or 2 years later or 3 years later, right? But in the immediate aftermath of the increase, employment actually increased by 13%, contrary to expectations. So how does the difference in difference work? So you see the first row says NJ, which is New Jersey. PA stands for Pennsylvania. FTE is full-time equivalent, so the number of full-time staff hired by the 410 restaurants. So average in New Jersey before the law, so I've started with after because subtraction becomes easier, but FTE after refers to what were the full-time numbers, or average number of staff full-time after the increase, and before is before the increase, so that's your baseline right there. The difference column is a subtraction of both those figures. So you're looking at before the law was implemented, New Jersey had stores had an average of 20.44 full-time employees. Pennsylvania had an average of 23.33 employees. So Pennsylvania was hiring more than New Jersey on average in the stores. And then in the after column, you actually see that New Jersey catches up, right? They have almost the same number of employees full-time. And so the difference in difference is 2.75. As a result of the effect, New Jersey stores on average increased the number of full-time workers by almost 3 people, right, on average. And in some stores it may have been 10, in some stores it may have been 20 or whatever it was, but on average that's what they increased. So this is a demonstration of the difference in difference approach. This is how you would do it. You have a control group, you have a treatment group, and then you look at their outcomes before and after. But the important thing is you have to have a control group. So you're doing pre and post, but you're also doing it for you're also doing it for a control group. You're not just looking at the treatment group. Because you're assuming the parallel trends assumption that if there are any other trends, they would affect both groups equally, right? So that's a demonstration of the DID approach. Any questions? Okay, so then we'll move on.
Take into consideration positive deviation as well as negative deviation.
Actually,
that would be treated as a difference.
I'm sorry?
See, that positive deviation and negative deviation, like in one particular case, it has increased.
Right.
In second case, it has decreased.
Right.
Like, difference means positive as well as negative.
Yeah, it does. And so there is one theory that people who are working in Pennsylvania actually moved to work in New Jersey, and that may have caused some of the increase. But this is all, since they weren't actually, they're using existing data, they're not actually, interviewing these staff or anything. All they were trying to demonstrate is the method, right? So what happened and what are the reasons behind it? I think they were interested in exploring that further, and I don't know if they're still working on that. They're a group of economists working on this issue. Yeah, go ahead.
The question is that this is, I won't say this is easier, but this is more systematic to examine what is the increase, what is the decrease over the span of 6 months. But when we go into the analysis, there is nothing concrete, or I would say more, we need more coherence. So what happens about the data analysis? Are we going to do that also, or is it just a evaluation only consists of finding out whether it has increased or decreased?
No, evaluation actually would give you the whole picture. So my role today is not to really talk about evaluation, it's to talk about methods. And so that's why I'm here talking about methods. But yes, typically, in this case, it was only a quantitative study, and this is a whole 50-page document out of which I'm pulling out one piece to demonstrate how a method is done. I'm not presenting results of this study, so I think we should be clear about that. This is a very comprehensive study, and I would be doing a disservice saying this is the only result they had. No, they did multiple more tests and multiple
analysis
more.
Part.
Yeah, there was a very substantive analysis part to it. If you look up Card and Kruger, even on the Google website, you will come across the. So I've given the references if you're interested in reading the study further. It's a very interesting study. All I'm trying to do is not present their results, because that would take me 2 hours on every study alone. All I'm trying to do is demonstrate the method. How did they use the method, right? So all the examples are only for method demonstration purposes, not to tell you how the study was done, because that would take much more time. But I would certainly recommend you read it, because I think it's a very interesting study, right? Yeah.
If we compare the FTE before and after, and
right.
If we add both immediately,
yeah.
So in that case, the FTE before is higher than the FTE mean.
If you, sorry, say that again.
I'm saying that if we compare FTE before for both the states.
Yeah.
And compare it with FTE after for both the states.
Right.
In that case, the total employment is decreased.
Right. Well, see, the thing, I think what they're trying to do here is, so there's a parallel trend assumption, and I think in the paper they've talked about what could be some of the factors affecting this. Like I said, this is not the place to talk about the full study and what they assumed. In the paper, they've made that very clear. So I'm not presenting the results of the study, just demonstrating how it's done. But like I said, one of the assumptions that is made in this method is that if there is a trend for decreased employment, then it affects both groups simultaneously, and so it balances out, right? So we have to look at, they've explained that in the paper, but I don't remember the details of the paper. They've explained how parallel trends are equal in these two cases. And the assumption, or one of the theories that they're proposing, is that workers, why is there a decrease in Pennsylvania? Because the minimum wage went up. At the starting, both states had the same minimum wage. And then New Jersey increased theirs. So it's obvious that a minimum wage worker who only has to drive 15 extra minutes to get to the next state will probably want to find employment there. So that's one of the things that they've said. However, they don't have qualitative research backing this up. They didn't actually go talk to all those workers in the 410 restaurants to say, okay, did you move from Pennsylvania, right? They were trying to demonstrate that this general belief may not always be true, that when minimum wages go up, employment goes down, right?
So what is the what would then it mean that we should continue with this policy for some more time and again take a stock of this after some time and
Well, I think their theory has been contested by other studies which said, no, this is not true. We did another sample and we found completely different results. That's not true. There's a group of economists who feels very strongly that based on research that they have done separately and with different samples. So this is one study. I think you're bringing up an important point. One study does not equal evidence because you're looking at a sample, you're not looking at the full group. So if I do a study in New Jersey and Pennsylvania, and maybe this is the result, you do a study in a different part of New Jersey and Pennsylvania, it may be a completely different result. So what we have to do in order to inspire policy that is evidence-based is do multiple studies. And like I mentioned in the beginning, nobody has time. Sometimes people in the sector who are practitioners don't have time to go around consolidating the results of 50 studies, and that's what I mentioned one of the services my organization does is to do that. There are not a lot of organizations that do that, but they compile the studies and say 50% of the studies said this, 20% said this, and then that's a clue to government or to policymakers to say, okay, here is what the evidence is suggesting, now let's discuss what we should do. So you cannot change policy on the basis of one study alone. It's not a good idea.
Or could we take a larger number of states and then...
You could, yeah, exactly. Or do, even in the same state, do more studies. So more studies before you try to change anything, unless it's a very small intervention for, let's say, 100 kids. There's no implication to that because you can, it's in your school and you can change it, right? But when it comes to policies like minimum wages, this is not decided easily. It takes a lot of debate before that is done. So before you change it, it's important to be able to make sure what were the findings across board. If most studies are saying employment is increasing, then that tells us something. But it could also be in the US it works like that. In India it works completely differently. So we can't make a universal rule out of it that just because this study showed wages have no effect, I mean employment actually increases, it doesn't mean that other studies, that you know in India we should be following it just because the US said that. That same result may not apply to a different part of the US, never mind India, which is completely different, right? So multiple studies, one study doesn't constitute evidence.
How could we sample so that we could have a result which would be, you know, taken as a valid result?
So sampling, like I mentioned to her, she had asked that question, is a whole... The sample would entirely depend on the kind of study that you're doing. So if it's qualitative, the kind of sample doesn't matter much. Because if you have 50 kids, you can interview all of them. But if you're looking at a whole country, then you have to make sure there is religious representation, there is that the male females are respected, that you have representation from each of the states, that you have representation from maybe the union territories if you think the results are going to be different, that tribals are represented. So if somebody is looking at evaluation of Narega, their sample would look very different from, and would be way more complicated than a sample of a study looking at 50 children. So this is why sampling is such a complicated. There's no one rule on how you sample. I think the best thing we can say is a random sample tries to average all of those out, but in some cases you have to do follow a different sampling method just because you want to get representation from everyone, and a random sample will not guarantee that, right?
In
so.
In cases of RCT, when we are, let's say, taking a state, let's say Delhi. So Delhi has population of, let's say, 50 lakhs. So in that case, how much, you know, if we take percentage, how much percentage of the population should validate?
Yeah. You, that depends on what's the power. There are complicated, there are some things you need to define, like what is the alpha level and what is the power stuff. These are statistical tools that you'll have to figure out because that helps you compute the sample size. So there are websites, if you just do a sample size calculator, if you look for it online, there are websites that do the calculation for you. But you have to decide on some technical stuff, like what is the anticipated power level, what is the alpha level that you would settle for. Those are all, I think, statistical stuff that we can't discuss today, unfortunately, because of a lack of time. But I think if you look up the website, you'll be able to figure it out, right? There was one more, I saw a hand.
One such assumption is that New Jersey laws may be more convenient than Pennsylvania.
There could be, well, I think the study was based on the principle of they both started with equal minimum wage. So what happens is, when you're trying to compare what is the effect of minimum wage in New Jersey, let's say, versus Texas.
County benefits or whatever.
There could be, but in this case, it was minimum wages persisted in both states, neighboring states, which means they were more comparable in terms, because they were neighbors. So you can't compare New Jersey and Texas and still come up with the same results, right? So what they were trying to do is find a comparison group that was as similar as possible to New Jersey. Pennsylvania is a bordering state, and the people who work freely work in both states. So it is likely that those results would hold for the comparison group, and that is why they use that as an example. This doesn't mean the study was foolproof. I'm not suggesting this is the ideal study and this is how we should do anything, because this same study has been criticized by other economists who say we don't agree with this result and we've done our own study which proves a completely different result, right? All I'm trying to demonstrate is the metric they used and to say this is how it can be used if you have a situation which might be similar, right? Yeah.
When it comes to the nature of employment, like see, minimum wage is not confined to one particular category.
Right.
Like skill, it is available to a skilled worker, unskilled and semi-skilled.
Right.
And in case of government employees.
Right.
Right. So whether all these parameters have been taken into consideration for conducting this research?
Yes, they only looked at low-skilled workers employed in fast food restaurants. Yeah. They're not applying this. Yeah. So that's another important caveat. This doesn't mean, so somebody asked the question on, so should we change the law now that should we, so now there should be no problem in raising minimum wages? No, because this is what they found from one study which looked at fast food restaurant, low-skilled fast food restaurant workers. It's not, maybe if there was an increase in minimum wage for my salary level, it would not make a difference. It would not have the same difference. This applied to a very, very specific low-skilled group, right? So in this study, in this particular case, it increased, the minimum wage change actually increased employment. But that same result may not apply to a skilled group at all of employees.
All categories of industrial.
Yeah. Yeah, it may not apply across the board. In fact, like I said, in a different part of New Jersey and Pennsylvania, a different study might come up with completely different results. So you cannot believe the results of one study. That's why drug trials are done multiple times and among multiple samples, because we don't want to threaten human life on the basis of one study, right? Okay, so moving on, the next one we have is propensity score matching. This is a form, or this is a design that looks at matching users. So it's another attempt at trying to find a control group. So how would we set up a control group? So if you have a large data set, this is one method you could follow, because this needs, because of the way that it's constructed, it needs a very large sample size. So you can't do this with small groups. It has to be larger groups. And this one is also probably not for those of you who hate stats, because it involves a lot of statistical techniques that have to be taken into account, right, during the analysis. So what I'm describing is the method, but the stats behind this is a completely whole different ballgame, right? So this particular one, we use statistical analysis to try and set up the comparison group based on a large data set. Treatment and comparison units are matched on observable characteristics. So we've talked about this. There can be many differences between two individuals and two groups. Some of them are treatment and some of them are observable characteristics, like whether I'm male or female, whether you are male or female, whether we are educated or less educated, whether we are employed or unemployed. These are all what we call observable characteristics. But there are a number of unobservable characters. So what's my attitude about, so right now without asking me, you will not know what is my attitude towards climate change, for instance, right? So we know in the US, there are some folks who believe that climate change is a hoax, and that there's no such thing as climate change. But I don't know your opinion on this, and you don't know my opinion on this, just based on all of us being in the same room at the same time, right? So this is a hidden characteristics. So people and groups can differ on both hidden and observable characteristics, and we have to take this into account when we're constructing data sets or constructing a comparison group. And this particular data technique matches on the basis of observables, which means that it doesn't account for hidden characteristics, and this is one of the flaws of this technique. So let's talk about propensity score matching. So this slide basically just tries to depict matching. So in the red shorts, you have some heavyweight champion who's a professional boxer. And in the blue short, you have Jimmy, who's also a boxer, but he's in the fourth grade, right? Do you think Jimmy makes a good comparison group for the gentleman in red shorts? No. So this is just a humorous way to say that when you try to match people, you have to take into account, you're not just thinking of two units, you're thinking of two human beings who differ from each other. And we have to, on their observable, because we cannot know their hidden characteristics, because remember, we may not be collecting the data. This is already large data sets that exist, like the government of India already has some data sets, etc. And so we have to figure out how can we build a control group that's as close as possible to the treatment, right? So let's say we have villager A, whose treatment, and then we have the option of villager B and villager C. And it says control question mark, control question mark. So we have two options. We can look at village B as the comparison group, or we can look at village C as the control group. Who would you pick?
C.
Okay, why would you pick C?
C. Similar
based on observable characteristics, which is essentially some lady in a blue colored lady in a dress, correct? So yeah, in this case, village C. So you've understood the technique perfectly. This is extremely simplified, this is not how real life works, but you understood the technique. You're looking for something that is as comparable as possible on the basis of observable characteristics, because we cannot see the unobservable characteristics, right? So here is village A and village B, and we match them on the basis of observable characteristics. What does that look like? It can get kind of messy. So I don't know if it's very evident to you, but say we have someone who, so this is the treatment unit, this is the theoretical control unit where we are trying to build this control unit. So somebody of age 19 who's probably male, who spent 3 months unemployed and who has does not have a secondary degree. And then we look in the potential control group list to see if there's someone we can match them with. And lucky us, in this particular case, we have a perfect match. And so we can match them, right? Unfortunately, this happens very rarely. It's very rare that you can find in your control unit somebody who's an exact match, who's male, who's exactly 19, who has been unemployed for exactly 3 months, and who does not have a secondary diploma, right? This doesn't happen. What usually will happen is, you'll have someone who's 19 and who's a male, but then you'll find he was unemployed for 6 months instead of 3, or he does actually have a secondary diploma, but that's bad news for you, because suppose you're studying employment or labor, you know education is very closely correlated with employment. So if you cannot match, because if someone has a secondary degree versus someone who doesn't have a secondary degree, they are not compatible, right? For many reasons. So in the simple world, this is how it would work out. You would have an exact match. And obviously you're dealing with hundreds and thousands of observations or people in your data set. You can't sit down on Monday and say, okay, here's one person who's 19 and 1 year old and whatever, 19 years old and male and 3 months unemployed. Now I'm going to sort through 5,000 records to find someone who's exactly like them. You don't have time to do this, especially when there are hundreds and thousands of observations in your data set. So there are computer programs designed to do this for you. But this is how it would look if we were to do it manually. This is how it would look, and so that's just to give you an idea of that. So essentially what, yeah. Yeah. So this is just the basic level. Essentially what the technique tries to do is, you have your non-enrolled group, you have your enrolled group. It tries to find the people who overlap, who in the treatment group and the control group have the same observable characteristics. This would form your sample of treatment and control. Right? Does that make sense? Just on the basis of the graph. Now, how would you do that? Yeah.
But one or the other characteristic, as you said, may be different. Then how is it possible to have a common group which would be having exactly similar characteristics?
So that's why it's called propensity score, and I won't get into the details because it gets into stats. But basically what it does is, it aggregates all the characteristics, the observable characteristics that you have in your data set, and it creates an index number. So age, sex, education level, whatever. You assign different weights to each of these observable characteristics. Based on that, the computer comes up with one index number, say 5.2. And each individual in your data set is assigned based on their combination of education, sex, all the observable characteristics. The computer computes, excuse me, an index number, whatever you might
call. Characteristic?
For all characteristics, across all characteristics, depending on the weightage you've given each characteristic. So if you think income should get double the weight, then the computer computes that score that way. Then what you do is you compare the score in treatment and control. You don't compare on individual characteristics, you take that overall score. So if my score is 5.2, then in the control group, I'd look for 5.2, right? And then that's how you would match them, because they may not match exactly. What the computer does the matching for you. It looks at who's male, who's earning 5,000 rupees a month, and who's whatever else. Okay, so those people get a score of 4. And then it will match for you who's 4 with someone in the control group who's 4 or closest to 4, like 4.1 or something, who can be compared, right? So the computer sets this up for you.
The real problem is most of the participants do not have sound understanding of research methodology. So it would be very, very difficult for them to analyze or like interpret any statistical statistical data of data analysis.
How this diagram will appear? No, this diagram doesn't appear.
It's just to tell you.
It is a software.
No, you don't need this diagram. This diagram is only to explain to you how it works. So
you have a treatment group. You have a control group, and what you're looking at is the people who are civil. That's all it does. So it's like a Venn diagram where you're not comparing people from here and here. You're comparing people from one here who have overlapping characteristics. Because you cannot compare, if I have a PhD, you can't compare me to somebody who has a primary school degree.
So what we're doing is, you can compare if somebody in the treatment, in the control group also has a PhD, then maybe we are comparable. But what we are looking for is areas of overlap. Who are the people who have scores of 5 or 4 or 3 in treatment and control who can be then compared? That is the basic purpose of what, right? And so to answer your question, from the way Professor Vajpayee explained to me, he just wanted an exposure on methods today, and then statistical training will have to follow, right? Okay, so propensity score matching. We have, like I mentioned, it's done on observables. So what's the weak area? We cannot know the unobservables, right? What are unobservables? This is just a list of some unobservable characteristics. So personality traits, intellectual capacity, all of these may not be relevant to the study that you're doing. I'm just showing these as an example of some things we cannot know based on a data set, unless these have been specifically tested for. If you've interviewed a group of people, so how do you deal with this? Excuse me, suppose for your study, you find, oh, but I also want to match on the basis of unobservable characteristics, because in my case, it's very important. So say there's a law, and I want to make sure that my people, I want to make sure that women's attitudes to, so women's attitudes, you can't tell from a data set because we don't know that, right? We can measure, we can compare women on the basis of, you know, their education levels, their income levels, whether they live in a joint family or a single family. These are all observable characteristics that may be in your data set already. But suppose whether or not you choose to abide by a law or whether you choose to take advantage of a law or not may depend on, let's say, the personality trait of the concerned woman. So maybe some women are more confident and that allows them to go to a police station and demand action because they are automatically more self-confident. So self-confidence is not something that exists in most data sets, right? But we know that self-confidence affects our results or affects our outcomes, so we want to be able to measure that. We want to turn an unobservable characteristic into an observable characteristic. What does that mean? If you have access to those women, then you would have to go and ask them about their confidence levels, right? So you that by collecting data, you can turn some of the unobservable hidden characteristics into observable characteristics and include them in the index then. So then the computer system would generate an index number that includes self-confidence and will measure women or will match women on the basis of the included self-confidence characteristic. But for that, you will need to collect that data and make it an observable characteristic. Does that make sense? Yeah, is that clear? Okay. And I should say, you can do this, self-confidence is an example I gave you. There may be hidden characteristics you can never capture at any point, but statistically there are techniques through which you can control everything that is not already in the data set, right? So, but just something to be aware of. So what we're talking about is propensity score method. So the index number I'm talking about, that's actually called the propensity score. What is the propensity or the likelihood of someone? It's the number or the index score that is assigned. That's why it's called propensity score matching. But as I had mentioned earlier, you can also use methods in combination. And so we talked about difference in difference earlier with the New Jersey and Pennsylvania minimum wage example. That compares trends across time and accounts for on-the-ground changes outside of the intervention, right? That was what difference in difference did. It looked at a comparison group and it looked at the, both treatment and comparison in two periods of time. But you can combine propensity score matching with difference in difference. So in the case of difference in difference, we just looked at New Jersey, we looked at Pennsylvania fast food restaurants. We didn't try to match them in any way, and that could be a flaw of the study. That maybe McDonald's in Pennsylvania is very different from McDonald's in New Jersey, thank you. Now, the authors actually argued that McDonald's is a franchise and functions in exactly the same way across the world, right? The menu varies a little bit, but otherwise McDonald's pretty much, I know one case in Sweden, I think, where there was some rioting and students burned down a McDonald's store. It was up and functional. I mean, they destroyed it completely, and within 2 days, it was up and functional again. Why? Because they have this prepackaged store stuff that is kept ready. It's just shipped and opened, unboxed, and set up. So they've got it down to a fine art because of the number of McDonald's they've opened across the world, right? So in that study, the authors actually argued that McDonald's is actually comparable both in New Jersey and in Pennsylvania. But let's say there's another study where it's not like a franchise and it doesn't, we're just comparing fast food stores. So you could have Nirula's, you could have McDonald's, you could have KFC or whoever else you want. And we could argue that the environment in one store is very different from the environment in another store, and therefore, how do we compare them? So therefore, this is a flaw in the study. So what you can do is combine PSM, propensity score matching, with difference in differences. But in this case, what you're going to be doing is you will match, use the computer system to match a fast food store in one state with a fast food store in another state, and then look at the effect across different periods of time. So that's a way to combine that, right? And graphically, that's how that would look, where you have, this is 2 points in time. This line represents the treatment group. That line up above represents the comparison group. These have been matched according to propensity score matching. So each was given an index and then matched by the computer. And you're looking at them at 2 points in time. So not only is the control group matched to the treatment group, you're also looking at them in 2 points of time with the assumption that if there were different economic trends prevailing from one time period to another, they would affect both treatment and comparison in the same way, right? So that assumption still holds. Okay, the next one talks about advantages and disadvantages. This one doesn't require randomization, so you can do it with existing policies, programs, laws, because there's no random assignment. Disadvantage is that it requires very large data sets. And
this is about PSM.
This is about PSM. It needs to control for all factors that influence program placement. And still, there may be data sets where you cannot find enough comparison units because that's just how the data set is, right? So it may not be possible. If after you've matched, after your computer has a program, has computed a propensity score, and then you look among the non-treatment group, the control group, you try to find similar units. It could be that in some cases, you simply are not able to identify matching units. So in that case, you can't use this method. So it's important to be clear about whether you have matching units or not before you proceed with this method. And again, another disadvantage is it assumes no systematic differences in unobservable characteristics. Right? So there may be differences, but they are not systematic differences which would influence the outcome you're trying to measure. That is an assumption. The only way to deal with this is, as I said, you can collect data on some of the hidden characteristics, but you can't do that for every possible hidden characteristic. So these are some of the disadvantages of using this method. Okay, here's an example of that. So as you know, pipe to water we talked about undefined mortality and diarrhea being a big problem. And so many states are investing in making sure that the residents of that state have access to piped water, right? So that it's clean water and that households have access to clean drinking water. So this particular research group, which is Jalan and Ravalian, did a study in 2003. Again, that's a reference you can look up if you want to read up the study. They looked at a data set that had 33,000 rural households. This is in India, by the way. 33,000 rural households from 16 states in India. This was an existing data set. They did not collect this data. And then they matched units, those who had access to piped water and those who did not. They matched them at the village level. So they first compared villages, because you know villages in India can be very different from each other. Some villages are nearer to the cities, some villages are more further, and so the facilities are going to vary, and the type of people who are there also will vary. So if a village is very remote, it's likely they may not have highly educated people, because unless they are migrating to another area. So first they matched at the village level, and then they matched at the household level, so that they could create comparison groups that were as nearly, as similar as possible to the treatment group. So they used propensity score matching, but they used two levels of it. They first matched villages, and then they matched people, households in those villages to most resemble each other. One part of the sample had access to piped water, and then the other half of the sample did not have access to piped water. And again, I'm not going into the details of the results, but just out of, if you're curious, they found, this is actually a no-brainer, they found piped water reduced diarrhea. I guess we could have guessed that. But they have generated the empirical evidence for this, that diarrhea prevalence was 21% higher, and it lasted 29% longer among households that did not have access to clean water, right? So they used this method. I will point out, call your attention to the fact that they looked at 33,000 households, and that gives you a clue into the advantages of this method, because if you were trying to collect data yourself, it would be almost impossible, unless you were the government of India or a very rich organization. You would not be able to collect that amount of data. It would take a very long time, and how different people would collect that data across different states, etc. So there is a risk of bias or error coming in, and it would possibly take a very long time to analyze this data and collect it and clean it and all of that. So this is where we said that if you already have an existing data set, PSM is a good way of trying to identify, using PSM as a way to identify a counterfactual group, right? Okay, before I move forward, anything else? All right, then we come to our third design, which is regression discontinuity design. So as you know, sometimes programs or interventions are assigned on the basis of a score. So I think the one that we all run into at some times in our life is, you're at least in Delhi or I think everywhere, where you have a class 10 board exam, and your score at that board exam determines on whether or not you get into a university program of your choice, right? So all university programs have a cutoff score, where people who are getting a score, a certain level of score, are let into a program, and people who are not getting that score or who are just below that score are not entered, you know, are not given entry into a program. So regression discontinuity designs, RDD for short, look at that division that is created between those who have a certain level of score and those who don't. They look at that to create a counterfactual group, right? That division that is created. So some examples of this is sometimes there's a poverty line cutoff for anti-poverty programs. So for instance, you could have people who are earning only the minimum wage being eligible for certain benefits, and those who earn above that are not eligible. So that's your eligibility index right there. Pension programs, at 65 you're entitled to pension, but at 64 you're not entitled to pension. So that's a discontinuity right there, because it divides people into two groups. And test score cutoff for scholarships or admission into university programs, etc., as I explained. So these are some examples. And these are used as the basis of the regression discontinuity design. So RDD is only possible when there is a continuous eligibility index. So it can't be, for instance, A, B, and C. So if you get A, you get into a certain area. If you get B, you don't get into a single area. Those are categories, not continuous scores. So we are looking for continuous scores because we want to see the change across the scores, right? And we need a clear cutoff defining people 65 and below get this. People 65 and above get this, and people 65 and below, 64 or younger do not get this. So you need a very clear dividing line. It can't be a hazy dividing line because that doesn't work well from statistical purposes. So this is what it would graphically look like. Say this is the baseline poverty index that's assigned on the basis of what our household might earn. This is just a hypothetical example. And this is the daily household expenditure spent on food, for example. So at the baseline poverty index of 50, let's say if a household has a baseline poverty index computed by some government or some NGO of 50, that makes them 50 or below, makes them eligible for a cash transfer program. But anything above 50 means they're not eligible. And against this, we will track what, based on your baseline poverty index, what is the household expenditure on, or it could be your academic score, or it could be anything. Basically, you're just plotting it against this continuous index here. And you have a clearly defined point where one group becomes control and one group becomes triage, right? So, who are we comparing? So clearly, if I compare someone who's on, who's 20 on the baseline poverty index, and then somebody who's here, that won't make sense because as you move this way, people and households get richer. These are the poorer households. So you know these poorer households are spending less on food. That's not surprising, they have less on money to go for, right? But maybe they're also spending a lower proportion of their money that they have on food. But clearly, we can't compare this group with that group. So what they do is they take the cutoff, this particular design takes this cutoff point and compares people on both sides of the line, just closest to the line, because the argument being, think about it in terms of a class exam, say the cutoff for a scholarship is 50. Somebody who got 49 is probably comparable to somebody who got 50, because it could be pure chance that they got 49. Maybe they made a silly mistake or whatever. It would be hard to compare somebody who got 20 with somebody who got 50 because there's a systematic difference there. It would be hard to compare somebody who got 80 with somebody who performed average at 50. But you can compare somebody who got 49 with somebody who got 50. There are chances they are similar in terms of their aptitude to education, right? There are always freak accidents where, let's say I forgot to put a total in a sum and I should have gotten 50 but I basically got 20 because I made a student mistake. That, there is always a chance of that. But remember, we're not thinking of individuals. In computing the sample, we are looking at individuals. In determining outcomes, we're not looking at individuals, we're looking at average, right? All statistical techniques talk about average. So while there could be fluke cases, even within this very narrow group here, there could be someone who just messed up and forgot to do the total on a sum and lost all 20 points. But apart from those flukes, typically you will have people who got 49 who are comparable to on average. Right, we're looking at average here. So this technique makes use of that. How do they do that? What they will do is, they will take that sample that I highlighted previously, the sample highlight, they'll only take those units around that line, on both treatment side and control side. That's going to be the, so on one side, the eligible side is going to be the treatment group, the non-eligible side is going to be the control group, right? The eligible side will then be given whatever the intervention is. So it could be, let's say, a cash transfer program because we want them to spend more money on household food. And then they graph with the help of software, whatever it is, SPSS or R or Stata, whatever you might use. They graph the line of whether or not, when you give the eligible people, this line remains constant, this is the people who are being treated, right? We're only looking at that narrow sample now. So you plot those, this is the original line. Here is the line of people, the revised line of people who were given cash transfers, and now you're plotting to see, did expenditure on food increase because we gave them a cash transfer? So are people's, our research question or evaluation question is, are people spending more on food now that they are getting, because they are getting a cash transfer? And this is the line that plots that. You see, the, so the original line should have been here.
the revised line, because they got cash on the treatment group got cash transfers, is here. So what is your impact? It's A minus B. Does that make sense? Yeah? The computer will generate this line for you. This graph is actually created by the computer. So based on your data, the computer will create the line. But that's not important. That's when you learn the software and how to manipulate the data, you will learn how to do that separately. All we need you to understand is, this would have been the original line, which we saw on the last graph. This is the increase in food expenditure, just because they received a cash transfer to help the households eat more, right? So by those standards alone, within whatever the caveats are, the cash transfer program was successful in increasing the level. If the line had been lower than the original line, then we would say it may, you know, maybe it had a worse influence. Maybe all the money came in and they spent it on drinking or some other, maybe repairing the house or whatever. It was not being spent on food. But in this case, we can tell that it is being spent on food, right? So what's an example? So the counterfactual is people just around the cutoff line who did not participate. The advantages are that the identification of the counterfactual group is already built into the design, because all you're doing is you're taking the line that was already there and you're dividing people into two, right? And it delivers marginal gains from the program around the cutoff point. So the results only apply to the group that's just below the line and just above the line. You cannot generalize the results to people on the two extremes. So you can only say that around this line, here are the effects of the program, right? Disadvantages, again, you need a large sample. The threshold has to be applied in practice, meaning suppose 50 was the limit against which you get a cash transfer. That was the eligibility criteria. But then I knew the program manager and I said, my score is 55, can't you just give me a cash transfer anyway, right? So if people in the, basically the sign is, if you use this, you have to make sure that people stuck, that line was strictly adhered to, because otherwise it's going to mess up your data. If the line was not strictly adhered to, there's something called the fuzzy regression discontinuity design, which just means a little more technically, like statistical stuff that has to be incorporated. It's still a regression discontinuity design, but we call it fuzzy, because now that line is not clear. It's fuzzy because some people who should not have gotten treatment actually got it, because they manipulated the system or whatever it is, right? So it's important to be able to tell that. An example of this is NREGA. I thought I would bring this as an example because everyone's at least familiar with the act. So as you know, or as you may know, it was implemented in three phases. What the Planning Commission did was they took all 650 districts in the country and they ranked them according to poverty, according to the poverty index, right, of their computing. Based on the ranking, they couldn't implement the program in all 600 districts immediately. So what they did was they assigned it phase-wise. And the poorest districts, who were absolutely the poorest districts, were scheduled to receive the program in phase one in the first year. So this was 2006, I think. In 2006, the poorest districts, 130, I think, the 130 poorest districts were allocated to the program. But they set up that discontinuity by saying, let's rank all the districts according to poverty, and the top 130 poorest districts will be, the NREGA will be implemented in those districts first. So there was a discontinuity created between the districts that received the program first, because based on a certain score, they made it to the 130, and then beyond that, you had phase two, which was the next 200 districts. So on the basis of that, somebody did a study. They used that as the discontinuity, the difference between phase one and phase two. They used that as the index to measure what are the effects on wages of men and women who participate in the NREGA program. And they found out that NREGA has limited impacts on men, on male wages, but that private wages, casual work, increased for women. So this particular study, again, there's a, I've put the reference there if you want to look it up. This particular study was looking at, did it affect casual labor wages? And so they used a regression discontinuity design. They compared women and men working in phase one as compared to women and men working in phase two of NREGA implementation.
and then they controlled for a number of different factors, and they produced this result saying the rider does not impact male wages, but it does impact female wages. Right? Question? Okay. So then we reach, we've been very patient, we reach absolutely the last method we have. So almost over. These are natural experiments. Natural experiments are variations or events that result in as if random assignment of beneficiaries and non-beneficiaries. This is how you would create the counterfactual. So in some cases, natural events include things like famines and earthquakes. So for instance, I know of a study, so suppose we want to find out with pregnant women, what does the effect of stress do to pregnant women? This is one of the cases where you cannot apply an RCT, because what that would mean is we take a group of pregnant women and then we randomly assign half of them to stressful conditions and we tell the other half, okay, you are the control group, right? Now this is unethical, nobody would allow you to do it. But people have, when an earthquake hits a particular region, it affects everyone in that region, right? And what they've done is, they've evaluated, some studies and researchers have taken, because they already had access to health records of women, like, you know, when they go for their monthly checkup or whatever, when women are pregnant, they've already got the weight of the woman and they've got certain details. They looked back on what happened to babies who were